Welcome to Podcast with KK Baidoo, where we answer the nagging questions on the top of your mind to solidify your Christian faith. My name is Alex Asu, and I'm in the studio with KK Baidoo. How are you doing, KK Baidoo?
It's exciting. I like the way the weather is. It looks very different, but I like it.
How is your family? How is ministry as well?
I'm enjoying what we're doing all across the world with young people. I can't wait for us to enter into some of the wonderful countries that is coming up in the months ahead. I can't wait for us to enter new countries. I love entering new countries and touching young people there for Jesus.
That's wonderful. Well, today's a very wonderful day as well, and we have a very interesting topic, and a very, very wonderful one. And this is something that everybody enjoys. I mean, it's everywhere, and we can't take it out of our lives as human beings. It's called music. Music is very powerful, and as we all know, wherever you pass on this earth, you find music. In the taxi, wherever, you know, on this earth, you find music around. And today, I want to answer a very, very serious question that many people have been asking, and the question is, what song should I listen to as a Christian? And so, KK, what do you think about Christian listening to secular music? Is there anything really wrong with it?
There's everything wrong with listening to secular music. You know, when we talk about secular music, I know people are going to fight me on it. We can talk about different types of music. Someone would say, but KK, what about the patriotic songs? Musum Ghana is going to be well, my school anthem, or my whatever, may not necessarily be gospel. What about those? Well, those are neutral songs, but I would say that you are, each time you are singing any song, all I would say is that for a Christian, don't just be a person who just listens to songs for the fun of it. Each time you are listening to any song, remember that music is powerful. And I can illustrate how powerful music is in a very, very, very simple way for all of you to understand. And that is, I'm sure all of you here, if I ask you to, do you remember the months of the year? How do you know which month has 31 days or which one has 30 days? You quickly sing the song you were taught in, primary school, 30 days, September, April, June, and November, all the rest of 31 and so forth. That's the power of music. If I want to illustrate the power of music, this is how I easily, this is one of the easiest examples that comes to me, because you see, music is powerful, and the power of music is the ability to give you high storage capacity, which you would never be able to have if you are not using music. You know, there are some people who actually use music to learn. They don't want to remember things. They store it in music, and all they have to do is to just sing it, out in the exam room, and they everything comes back to them. So music is critical. So for a Christian, when I see Christians, there's nothing wrong. It's not, I'm not in for, making people say, some music is wrong, this music is right, this, no. I'm saying, as a Christian, don't just open your heart to any music, because music carries with it something that will affect you. And I'm saying that the power of music, I can mention about three powers of music. Number one is its ability to give you memory that is everlasting almost. Up to today, you won't believe it, Alex. When some songs are played, I'm sure some of those songs, when it was played when I was even a baby, but suddenly it gives my mind such a flashback. I have no idea of controlling that. You know, I'm certainly thrown into some mode or some mood, and that's how powerful music, the power of memory. And the second thing is the power of words that are inside there to move you to do something. The words in every music is powerful. And later on, I'm sure you're going to ask me some questions which will make me talk about that. And another thing about music is that it has the ability to make you do things. It can make you do some things. Bishop Dago would say that sometimes, he was giving an example someday about how people in a club, nightclub or something, they will be there and they will be just not dancing normally. And then all of a sudden, just some music is played and everybody starts smooching somebody or start. Music is powerful. It's powerful. Yeah.
Music is indeed powerful. You brought into memory a lot of things that, you know, I also used to do in the past because of music. I still can remember some of the poems in, you know, primary school and kindergarten, like A Lion Has a Tail and all that. Even now, the things I learned in university, I've forgotten some of them.
Yeah.
But music is very powerful indeed. And thank you for this very wonderful answer. And my second question to you is that, what will you say about the secular artist who sings, you know, a gospel song?
Really, my challenge with music is really about two things. Although there are about five parts to music, there are five various parts to music. When we talk about music, we can talk about what I call the lyrics, you know, the lyrics, which is, for me, the most important part, the words that come with the music. What is the person saying? Like, you can have someone singing, Ole Sekeni Woye, and people would sing after them and say, oh, it's a joke. But no, how can you joke with such a thing? That I am mad. I am mad. No, you don't do that. And the other part of a music that is what we call the melody. The melody will be the arrangement, the way it's going, whether it's a reggae song, whether it's a R&B, whether it's classicals or whatever. You know, that's what we get. And then the third part of it is the artist. Who is singing? Who is singing the song? You can't take that part out of it. Who is singing the song? And then we have what we call the spirit of the music. Now, the spirit of the music is what I call the inspiration. What inspired the person who is singing the song to sing it? So you can't just separate that and say, oh, the person who is singing the song is a normal guy. It's important that you have all of these things in place, yes.
Okay, well, talking about the component and mentioning the artist especially, I want you to just tell us something about this. You know, recently, Shatawale, one of the dancehall, you know, artists in Ghana, made a very, you know, interesting statement that he is a prophet of God. And my question to you is that, and I've also heard other, you know, secular artists saying that they get their inspiration from God. Can that be true? I mean, what do you think?
Yeah, I realized I didn't even answer your first question, which was
artists listening to, you know,
singing
song,
singing gospel song. Yeah. Sorry, after talking about the part of the music, I forgot. Now, for me, the two things is the artist. So I say to people like this: an artist who is playing, if you say this secular artist is playing a gospel song. One of the questions I'll ask you as a Christian is, if this secular artist opens a church, will you become a church member in his church? Mm-hmm. Because I think every song is a short sermon with music. Mm-hmm. If you ask me what is a song, every song is a short sermon with music. And so when such a person opens up a church, will you be ready to attend this person's church? For me, that's the critical question. Now, so really, it's about, for me, for music, if I'm supposed to listen to a song, I really ask myself two questions. Mm. Who is singing the song? Mm. And what is he saying? Mm. Who is singing the song? And what is the person saying? Is the person just singing the song, or who is that person? Now, once I satisfy myself with two of these two answers, I'm home and dry. For example, I used to listen to Prayer Changes by R. Kelly, and The Storm Is Over, and some of his songs. Even the I Look to You by Whitney Houston was written by R. Kelly, you know. But I had to eventually, at a point in time, pack all of his songs and say, no, I'm not going to, I will better listen to somebody else. Because you see, you really, really cannot separate the artist from the song that he's singing. Because then, if I don't know the artist, fine. But if I know this artist and I'm beginning to like his song, I'm one way or the other, once you like the person's songs, I'm going to like the person as well. You know, because you'd have to condone or sometimes, you know, vote for, listen to that person's song, one way or the other, you know, says you are voting for the person. I remember listening to this guy who was a Muslim that has become a Christian. He says he was converted totally by the Quran. Mm-hmm. And he was saying that one of the things that he asked some of his chief imams that they couldn't answer was, he went to them and asked them that, he said, first of all, he asked the imam that, what did God use to create the world? And he said, the imam said, it's the word. God used the word to create the world. And he asked, is the word creator or is the word creation? And he said, the imam could not answer, because if he said that the word is creator, then it means that the word is God. And if he said the word was creation, then you have to ask, what created the word? You know, and so it's in the same way. Therefore, it means that whatever you say is you. And so when somebody is saying or singing a song, you cannot say, I like the song, but I don't like the person. There's nothing like that. This is one and the same. And so we have to be very careful. So if you say that there's a secular artist who is singing a gospel song, the question I really will ask you is that if that person opens a church, are you going to be a full member of that church? If not, you would have to throw away his songs, because his songs are his sermons and his songs is himself. Yeah.
Wow, that's amazing. Actually, you've answered one of the questions I wanted to ask you concerning...
I don't know whether I've answered the Shatawale one.
Just, no, you can just add a little
bit. Well, he says he's a prophet of God. And if he says he's a prophet of God, well, people can speak. God used even a donkey to speak. I'm not by that, unfortunately, saying that Shatawale is a donkey, but I'm just saying that. No, if he says that, I cannot be able to judge him on that. Well, he's between he and his God. But I know that Lord Kenya, he in that same article, I read it on my journal line, he was saying that he believes that Lord Kenya's prophecy that said that he was going to become a gospel musician and preach the word of God could very likely come to pass. So if this is where it is heading towards, I'm in for more people to join the kingdom of God. So why not? Yeah.
Yeah, that's interesting. I think, like I was saying, I think you answered the question I wanted to ask you about people saying that they love the song, but they don't love the artist. And you made it very clear that you cannot separate the artist from the song, because your words are you. And then my next question to you, now I know this guy is a young Christian in a church and loves music a lot, like everybody does. And he says that, I love listening to music and, you know, a lot, but I don't practice what he says. Are there people like that? Is it very possible that you can love, you know, listening to music and don't do what it says?
Well, I will find a little difficult. You know, the Bible says very clearly in Romans chapter 10, verse 17, that faith cometh by hearing, hearing the word of God. Now, therefore, if we want to extrapolate that or extend that, we can say that fear also comes by hearing, and hearing the word of the devil or any other word apart from the word of God. Therefore, anything I know, I have been saying the IDA principle all of the time, that I know we'll do another podcast on how to have faith, because a certain boy yesterday asked me when I went to CEM about the fact that how do I have faith? Mm-hmm. And I had to use the IDA principle to tell him that faith, the Bible says it very clearly, to have faith is very easy. You just have to hear or listen to the word of God consistently. Surround yourself, eat it, listen to it, sing it, do everything. So to surround yourself with the word of God, the desire for the word of God will be generated inside of you, and then you will act on it. So if somebody says, I listen to a song, I don't do it, I will have a little problem. You know, it's just like someone, a friend of mine, you know, recently I saw him, he's put on his screen saver, he has a girl with his breast exposed. So, oh, it's just a picture. You see, people don't know that for every information that you hear, it affects your desires. Mm-hmm. It will move you and it will move your emotions. Mm-hmm. There's nothing like innocent information. Mm-hmm. And you would have to, at the end of the day, your body reacts to. You know, the Bible says that guard your heart. Proverbs chapter 4, 23. Mm-hmm. Says, guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it arises every issue of life. Mm-hmm. Every issue of life arises out of your heart. So one of the things we need to understand is that if we want to control the issues of our life, which is the actions that we do, we should not go at changing the actions. We should go at changing what we are listening to. So either this guy is misinformed. He does not know what the word of God says. The word of God says no information is innocent. Anything that you hear will move you. That's why the Bible can say confidently that evil communication, or evil, another way of saying that, that word communication is more like evil company. What you are surrounding. You can have, that's why people have put earphones in their ears. It is company. When people have earphones in their ears, they are in a new world. They are having company, the company of their music. Evil company, wrong words in music. Even listening to wrong words, Alex, is bad and can affect you. How much more adding the power of music to it? Eesh. You are at another level. Anybody who says, I listen to a music, and you see, sometimes you can see people living in villages, they have not seen the people who play some of those hip-hop tracks. Mm-hmm. But after they listen to the song for a very long time, they start dropping their trousers or their pants, you know, just like how those hip-hop guys are. Mm-hmm. Because there's something we call the spirit of the music, which is the inspiration that came for the person to do that song. That's why for me, someone like, at a point in time, I need verification on it, on this. I really used to like even instrumentals. We didn't have lyrics by Kenny G. Mm-hmm. But I had to stop because I don't know how far it's true, but I researched on the net. I saw that some way, somehow it was true. But the net can be deceptive, and I stand to be corrected, that Kenny G was a state satanist. And so I stopped. I stopped listening to his music because although his instrumentals were very nice, the inspiration that he was getting, there was no words being spoken. Mm-hmm. But hey, Charlie, you can see somebody, when you are watching a movie, mm-hmm. just by playing some instrumental somewhere, it makes you cry, mm-hmm. or it makes you smile, or it makes you afraid. Tell me, you are listening to a movie, here, dun, 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 it makes your heart start beating a certain way because there's nothing like innocence. Somebody dreamed it. Once it was a creative byproduct of somebody, it carries along with it the inspiration within the person had. And that is what the person will try to communicate to you. And anyone who is listening to it will be affected by it one way or the other. Maybe you won't see the thing as drastic as it is, but over time, you will see it.
Wow, but over time you'll see it. And as he said, that no information is innocent. So it's really a very big lie to tell yourself that you just love the song but don't love the artist. It's not very, very possible. And also to add up, I think you mentioned something little about it, but I want to just go into details a bit. I met this guy in church and we're talking, and I found out that he loves listening to hip hop. So I was trying to talk him out of it and trying to explain to him that it's not something that God recommends for us. And he said that, oh, but like, you know, I just love the beat. I don't really love the words, just the beat. You know, it moves me to do something good. So what do you think? Is it possible that you can separate the beat or the rhythm from the entire music?
No human being has that capacity to do so. No, there's nothing like that. I've met so many guys who, you know, especially some of these guys that do choreographed dances. Mm. They always tell you, oh, I'm just listening to other songs for beats so I get dance moves. Those guys always end up in trouble. Mm. You would go that way. Then you don't have that capacity. Mm. It's like someone who told me some time ago that she even watches pornography. She doesn't really watch the pornography, but because she said she's just watching styles for her future marriage. And I can tell you, this girl has never been able to break away from sexual addictions. One time she herself, in another testimony, she was saying she's struggling with sex. And we asked her, you know, so you don't have that capacity. You don't have that capacity to sieve or to sift lyrics from melody. No, you don't have it.
You don't have that capacity. None of us have it. Now, kicking my final question to you. I mean, you can't talk about songs without talking about love songs. Mm-hmm. We know love songs are everywhere. Everybody listens to love songs. We all like love songs. And Bible even talks about the fact that love is the greatest of all. Love is something, it's an emotion we all feel and we cannot do without. What do you think about love songs? Is anything wrong with love songs, especially for would-be couples or probably those who are even married? What is wrong with a Christian couple or would-be couple listening to a secular love music or, yeah, a love song?
I don't know whether it was earlier this year or whenever that we had Sonny Badu listen to, I think he danced at his wedding with Kwabna Kwabna's song also, and it brought up a lot of controversy about whether we should listen to love songs or not. Well, unfortunately, Alex, you'd realize that the songs that people are talking about, which is love songs, and Ofori Ponson has said that he was justifying his way back into secular music with the excuse that he's singing about love songs. But we know, you and I who know and have studied the Bible, know that the love they are really talking about is eros, mm-hmm. for the most part. And the eros, when it comes to eros, as Christians, we believe that eros belongs into marriage. And so for a person who is not married and you are listening to a lot of these love songs, you end up, you know, some way. And one of the things I tell people is that if you want to look at how these so-called people are singing about, look at some of their own lives, you know, whether they epitomize the love they are singing about. The love that we as Christians need to sing about is the love that was depicted on the cross, which is agape, the unconditional love. And, you know, eros is good, but eros is very, 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 very selfish. And it actually belongs only in marriage, and it stands on the foundation of agape. If you ask me, I think people should sing more about the love or agape, which is the love of forgiving, not keeping wrongs, of being kind, being patient. These are the things we need to be singing about. The whole idea of love songs will only end up stirring up your emotions, and if you don't have the proper place to place them, you can get them wrongly. Yes, eros has a place where it belongs. It belongs in marriage. But even for married couples, I'll say it all applies. Don't just listen to any song from any other artist. I'll apply the same principle. If I want to listen to a love song, there are so many love songs that have been sung by CC and BB Winans. Those are the songs I listen to. You know, I would question, not that I'm judging anybody, but I apply the same principle. Well, if this guy opens a church, will I attend his church? If I will attend his church, I will listen to his song. You know, for me, that's the principle. So, even to listen to love songs, as a married person, I would, you know, apply that principle and not just listen to anybody who is singing the love songs for the sake of it. Yes, I do know some wonderful songs by Kojuenchi, Dadia Noma, and some other people. Even Ofuriam Ponsan has also sung some love songs, but I dare say that I will apply that same caution. I will not easily listen to some of those songs unless I am, I have applied this principle of if they open their church, I will attend. If not, no.
Wow, that's very amazing. I think it's very, very true that, you know, you cannot separate it at all. And then it's very also true that most of these songs are based on errors, just trying to stir up some desires that are not really wanted. I also remember how I used to listen to Westlife a lot and Celine Dion, and how it stirred up, you know, lustful desires in me. And it's not innocent at all. Definitely makes some, you know, change in your life. Thank you very much, KK, for your insight today as well. God richly bless you.
Amen. Thank you too.
So you've been listening to Podcast with KK Baidoo by Teens Aloud Foundation. Just a recap of a few things we learned today. He mentioned that music has a lot of power. You know, in music is the power of memory, is the power of words to move you. In music gives you the ability to make you do something that probably you didn't even think of doing. He mentioned about the four components of music, talking about the lyrics or the words, talking about the melody, you know, the rhythm and the beat and all that, talking about the artist, and then finally the spirit or the inspiration of the song. And he also said that there's no way you can separate the artist, you know, of a song, you know, from the words of the song, because the words of the artist are the artist himself. And therefore, don't say that I love the song but I don't like the artist. It doesn't work that way. And he also mentioned that you cannot also say that you love the beat, just the beat, you know, and don't love the music, because definitely the beat also was inspired from somewhere that the artist is connected to, and definitely will also influence your life. Thank you very much for listening to Podcast with KK Baidoo by Teens Aloud Foundation. Remember that for more resources like these, like the KK Baidoo Ministries or the Teens Aloud Foundation page on Facebook, or email us at jesus@teensaloud.com. Please prayerfully consider donating to Teens Aloud Foundation to help KK Baidoo and the team to reach young people worldwide for Jesus. Call us on +233 273 400 400, +233 273 400 400 for ways you can donate. God richly bless you.